Jesus says in Matthew 16, 24, 26, he says, take up your cross and follow Jesus. Then Jesus told his disciples, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his soul? Or what shall a man give in return for his soul? I happened to read on the Facebook feed how Dan Andrews, the Victorian Premier, decided to put a cascade. I don't know what the word is. I can't think of it. It's the buffer or whatever term you use. He wanted to cordon off the whole Anzac site and not allow people to actually be part of the site. The problem with this day and age is that we all have focus on ourselves because of the fallen and broken nature of the world. The tendency for humanity is to think about self and ourselves and to not think about others. When we think about this world we live in, that so often mental health and other issues are becoming more and more dominant because we simply are not connecting with each other. And it's a real wrestle against, you know, trying to keep ourselves in ferment with Jesus when we're constantly wrestling with the self aspect in our everyday lives. Even on this channel here, I get no views. I get very few views. I get very few likes because this world is a fallen and broken world. And the truth of the matter is that we have to look to Jesus. Yesterday I went to Catalyst Church and I went up for a spiritual baptism, not because I wanted to do it, but because the means to becoming more and more involved with Christ and knowing God is far greater and more beneficial than anything of this world. And as we think about Anzac Day, we've become so selfish in ourselves and so preoccupied with self that we actually forget about the symbolism and the significant import of Anzac Day itself. We've lost touch of reality. We don't care about each other. We don't care about anyone else. We only care about self. And when it comes to Anzac Day and the fact that freedoms were like, you know, in the battle of freedoms were fought over human exchange, and we simply cannot even be bothered to recognize. You see, the difficulty is that in this day and age, that self is becoming more and more of a problem. It's all sort of hypocritical in a way that we're supposed to be our own fortresses and we're supposed to be totally self-sufficient and dependent on ourselves. And yet when we get to breaking point, we wonder where people are. We wonder where the supports are. We wonder where the human efforts are, where those in Christ are. Yesterday I happened to be at the Catalyst Church and I was talking to some people there. And they kindly offered me an orchid. And they had an orchid. They said, would I be interested? And I thought that was so kind and loving of them. And I went over and I was able to get a piece of orchid and also be able to get a little stump cut off that would allow me to grow the orchid. And I thought, it's good to be in a loving Christian family. Sure, not everybody's going to want to talk to me, but it's good that we have those brothers and sisters in Christ that are there to help us. But when I went forth for this baptism in the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, he came into me and through the minister and through others, and we were able to speak in tongues. But, you know, the problem, folks, is that I can be seen as being negative because I look at the negative aspects of the world, but really the world's people are suffering because they don't really know Christ and his love. And I think that all we can hope for is that because because the devil, you see, what when we think about the rebellion, which we all have partaken of the rebellion because Adam sinned by listening to the devil, all of us have fallen and become focused on self, about us. It's all about us, what we want to do. And Galatians 5 says, the works of the flesh and of the spirit. Stand fast, therefore, in liberty by which Christ has made us free, and do not be entangled again with a yoke of bondage. Now, when we think about Christ making us free, we also think about the sacrifices that were made in Gallipoli, where men, young men, fought to allow us as a nation, New Zealand and Australia, to be able to have freedom. Do you think it's a matter of being about self when you actually, someone goes into a battlefield? Do you think that for someone that's in their 20s, a young man today, that if he goes into battle, that he's doing it for self or country? Or is he doing it primarily for an act of freedom? But if I just read this to you, because this is not about me, it's about God talking. The works of the flesh and of the spirit. Paul says, stand fast, therefore, in the liberty by which Christ has made us free. And do not be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Indeed, I, Paul, say to you that if you become circumcised, Christ will profit you nothing. And I testify again to every man who becomes circumcised that he is a debtor to keep the whole law. I don't really fully understand the term of circumcised, but he goes on to say, you have become estranged from Christ. You attempted to be justified by law. You have fallen from grace, for we, through the Spirit, eagerly wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision avails anything, but faith worth working through love. You ran well who hindered you from obeying the truth. The persuasion does not come from him who calls. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. I have confidence in you, in the Lord, that you will have no other mind, but he who troubles you shall bear his judgment, whoever he is. But we know that as we go on, and that what is it that we need to be doing to be able to be the yoke of Christ, not about self. And it disappoints me that in this country and in the world, that I don't want to glorify war by any means, but I think Satan is really working overtime to just take more and more love out of people, to make a robotic human race, mainly precipitated by an increase in information technology, which is causing robotics. I don't want to go into that too much anyway. And if you want to think that's bull crap, then that's your right. I don't really care, because it's not about me. It's what I feel. But the thing we need to remember is that Paul says in Colossians 1, devotion to Christ above all. He says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the saints and faithful brethren in Christ who are in Colossae, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We give thanks to God and our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of your love for the saints, because of the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, of which you heard before in the word of the truth of the gospel, which has come to you, as it has also in the world. And, you know, I just thought one of the things is that when we think about the rebellion, and this is the thought that I had last night, that God created man of the dust of the ground, and breathed in his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being, Genesis 2:7. It was man that decided to listen to the devil through the woman, because the woman was deceived by the serpent. If Adam would have had authority, and he would have stuck with the Lord, perhaps he could have said to the woman when she offered him the fruit, God told us not to eat of the tree of knowledge. Don't eat the fruit. I forbid, I'm not going to eat it. I don't want it because God told me not to eat of the tree of the garden. But what happened? Man chose to listen to the woman that was deceived by the serpent, which was Satan. But you know, the whole reverse order occurred through the woman by God, because God chose the woman Mary through the Holy Spirit to allow her to conceive, which she did, and she bore Jesus. So where is the dowry? And it says in 1 Corinthians 15:21-22, for since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead also came through a man. For in Adam all die, and Christ all are made alive. Romans 12:21 says, do not be overcome by evil, but do good to overcome evil. And, you know, with the birth of Jesus into the world and in the spirit, you see the downward spiral is with Adam, is that death goes to the ground, death goes to the world, but through Christ, death happens in the ground, but resurrection happens in the spirit. And that's what I believe, that it's the important thing to understand in our daily walk in this world. And I think that it's, you know, Hebrews 4 says, therefore, let's be sure to enter the promised rest. Therefore, since a promise remains of entering his rest, let us fear lest any of you seem to have come short of it. For indeed the gospel was preached to us as well as to them, but the word which they heard did not profit them, nor being mixed with faith in those who heard it. For we who believed you do enter that rest, as he said, so I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. Although the works were finished from the foundation of the world, for he has spoken in a certain place of the seventh day in this way, and God rested on the seventh day from all his works, and again in this place they shall not enter my rest. Since therefore it remains that some must enter it, and those to whom it was first preached did not enter because of disobedience. Again he designates a certain day, saying in David, today, after such a long time, as it has been said, today if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. For it is, if Joshua had given them rest, then he would not afterward have spoken of another day. There remains therefore a rest for the people of God. For he who entered his rest has himself also ceased from his works, as God did from his. Let us therefore be diligent to enter that rest, lest anyone fall according to the same example of disobedience. For the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit, and of joints and marrow, and is discerner of thoughts and intents of the heart. And there is no creature hidden from his sight. All things are naked and open to the eyes of him. We must give account. Seeing then that we have a great priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weakness, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. And that's what we do need to do, is to turn to the Lord in time of need and to realize the world is not the way that we need to be following. Thanks very much for watching. May God bless you.